Now to our series on the economic concerns of Trump voters in a few hard-hit areas of the country. This week, we're listening to them describe their hopes for Mr. Trump now that he's president. Jeffrey Brown is here with more.
Our colleagues at Frontline traveled to regions that once voted Democratic but voted for Donald Trump in this election. Last night, we heard from miners in West Virginia coal country. Tonight, a profile of a couple in Erie County, Pennsylvania. It's part of How the Deck is Stacked, the NewsHour's collaboration with Frontline and Marketplace in conjunction with the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
Okay, I'm Joe Arengia, and this is my business, Joe's Gym, Erie, Pennsylvania, current world champions. I'm a veteran, I'm on Social Security, and I'm a businessman. I've been undefeated world champion since 1993. I teach people how to get their life back. The only way you're gonna get your life back is get your strength back.
I wanna see Erie the way it used to be. We've gotta get our manufacturing back. For the sake of my children and grandchildren, I hope something happens.
So Erie has lost nearly 1 in 3 manufacturing jobs. You know that, all I can do, I flew over. You're looking at the plants, but you see them. They're falling over. The rain, the sleet, the snow. The wind, these are great buildings that are falling apart. I promise, we can fix it so fast. We're gonna bring it back. We're gonna bring back our jobs. We're gonna bring back our companies.
50s and 60s, when I was a kid, it was awesome. And my dad raised 7 of us kids as a coal miner, worked his butt off. They moved up here when I was 1 year old to go to work at GE. My brothers and my nephews, they all worked at GE. They wanted me to go down to GE, but I said, I like this physical stuff. Because I was a bridge builder, iron working bridge builder, a local 348 union. I was one of their best climbers, so I always got the job of putting the buildings together, which was fun. You climb up the column, big piece of steel comes up, you bolt it up, you walk out, unhook the cable, and stand there and wait for the next piece. Everybody had good jobs, everybody had good paying jobs. You know, I need a car, I had the money to go buy one, I was making my house payments, feeding the family. Even when I retired from the ironwork, I didn't have to retire. They didn't want me to retire. I says, I want to run a gym. I want to get my gym going.
Okay, put it back. I'll lower it a little bit more.
I put up the big buildings for the Hammer Mill Paper Company. 10-story buildings in here. I put them up. I was the connector. I put these, yeah, I had fun. I loved it. They're gone. The people are gone. It seems like about the last 15 years, things have really sucked because a lot of people are leaving the area because the manufacturing jobs have left. There's no work. And I used to see all these guys walking down the street with their lunch bucket in their hand going to work. Now you see them walking down the street with food stamps.
I had a lot of members here from GE. I don't anymore. I think I have 2. A lot of them left Erie. They're not even around Erie anymore. My wife runs a business. She owns Custom Audio right up the road here.
The minimum I put in here is 8 hours a day. Last night I was here 14 hours. My wife puts in minimum of 60 hours a week and sometimes 80. We have to.
Okay. Love you.
Love you too.
Thank you.
So I'm Sandra Lee Arengia. I've owned an electronics store for 33 years. A couple years ago, I really cut back on the staff. And we're really lean right now. And I think a lot of business owners are treating their businesses that way. What's happening to Erie is GE is transitioning down to Texas and Mexico. So those really good paying jobs will be leaving. Some of the other shops can't afford those higher paying jobs. They can pay well, but not as well as what some of the other workers, you know, GE are used to.
Love people, all kind of people. I want to see the American patriots, the American people that love this country, be happy and healthy. When your health goes, this goes. I've been knocked down thousands of times in my life in everything I've done, and I came back stronger than ever.
Jeez. Coming up, you got it, you got it.
Nice.
Okay.
Is it 9 or 10?
It's 10.
Okay. He's an animal.
I was actually a Democrat way back, because my family was, back when Democrats made more sense to me.
The Democratic Party is so strong here, and then you get someone like Donald Trump, who is really a very different candidate. I mean, we've never seen anything like him before. And I think that scares people. But I think the people who voted for him, they're hopeful.
So that night during the election, I sat up until the local news came on. He won Erie, which has not been won by a Republican since the 80s. If things get even just a little bit better, okay, let's give him another 4 years, because maybe it'll get a little bit more better. Okay, go for another minute on that. Watch that clock for 1 minute, you're done. If things get worse, no. Keep it going. 5 more seconds. I got to give him a chance. But I'm still probably going to go back to independent, because I still don't agree with a lot of either one of them, and I have my own ideas. And try to go with the best person, not the best party.
Come on, come on. You got it.
Good enough. Okay. Thank you.
Nice.
And that's it for today.
We asked two economists who've served in past administrations to watch these reports. Douglas Holtz-Eakin served in the George W. Bush administration. He's now with the American Action Forum. And Jared Bernstein worked for Vice President Biden. He's now at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities. Welcome to both of you. Jared, let me start with you. There's no denying the problem that we just saw. What struck you watching these videos?
I saw considerable despair, but I also heard great deal of hope there. And it was a kind of hope that has been very much amped up by Donald Trump's rhetoric around the campaign, the kinds of jobs and sectors he's arguing that he can bring back to those communities. And man, they really need those jobs and sectors. My concern, my fear really, is that he can't deliver on that hope. And despair met with hope that doesn't end up being delivered, that's a problem.
All right, let me get a first impression from Douglas Holtz-Eakin. What did you see? What did you hear?
Well, I think a lot of the things that Jared heard. I mean, number one, these are stories of great distress. That's real, it's palpable and unmistakable. There's also a longing for a past that it's not realistic to expect a return. I mean, Erie, Pennsylvania is close to my hometown. It's no longer the transportation hub it was when we had the Erie Canal and water transportation as the central part of the U.S. economy. And, you know, coal is not the same in the presence of Western coal that competes with it or natural gas that competes with it. So a realistic assessment talks about what can their future be, not what was their past.
Well, that's so, Doug, start with that. I mean, help us think about what a president can do and look at some of the things Donald Trump is talking about, at least. Tax reform, for example, tax cuts.
I think there's an enormous amount that the president can do on tax reform. We have a tax code that, broadly speaking, favors foreign production over domestic production. A good reform would neutralize that and shift things back to the U.S. when they're driven offshore by taxes. That'd be a great step. That doesn't mean they'll land in Erie, or that doesn't mean they'll land in coal country, but it's something that should be done.
Well, Jared, I mean, would those kinds of things have an impact on the workers we saw?
Perhaps at the margin, but I think we put way too much weight on tax reform as economists. You know, we've had very different tax regimes while globalization has been ongoing, and you've seen what's happened in these communities. So I don't think we can count on tweaks in the tax code, and Doug and I could probably agree on some very good ones because the tax code is pretty messed up, and hope that this globalization toothpaste will somehow go back in the tube, which is what I hear Donald Trump promising. And I agree with Doug. What needs to happen is that these communities have to adapt to globalization, which doesn't mean you can get back jobs that aren't coming back, but it does mean that you can make a play for advanced manufacturing, for new industries, for new types of energy. I don't hear that coming out of this administration.
What about one thing you do hear is pushing individual companies to stay, right, or to not move jobs offshore?
Yeah, well, that's mostly public relations. That's not a systematic economic plan. Now, frankly, I kind of like when the president takes the bully pulpit and says, you know, we want you to keep jobs here. That's kind of old school, but it resonates with me. But
I mean,
it
that could be
not
old school liberal, right?
Yes, but it's not an economic plan. It's not a systematic strategy that will help deliver the goods to the kinds of communities we're talking about.
Doug Holtz-Eakin, what do you think about that kind of move? And that kind of move, and then there's also the deregulation that he talks about.
I think the bully pulpit is fine, but, you know, businesses follow economic incentives. And once you give them a good chastising, the economic incentives are still the same. And unless you change them, over the long haul, the results will be the same. So bully pulpit's great, but following through and actually changing the incentives they have and the kinds of things that get produced in these communities is the key. And I think that taking a good, hard look at the regulatory state makes sense. We have seen a dramatic decline in the startup of new businesses in the United States. It's something that's happened across sectors. It's not just in manufacturing or just in retail. And so there's something going on there. And we know that when you start new businesses, that's when you get the job growth, that's when you get the new opportunities, and that's something that I think any administration should look closely at.
What is the, I think, Jared, you brought up the word hope that we heard from these people. We heard the woman in Erie say people who voted for him, Donald Trump, they're hopeful. How important is the psychological factor?
Well, I think it's important, but I also think it's omnipresent. I've been to places like this, and you constantly run into folks like that who really have hope for the future. And what it is that they want to participate in the economy. Structural changes, globalization, these kinds of, you know, the loss of the unions, the kind of labor standards kind of eroding, they've really hurt these folks. And what they would like is a chance to ply their trade. Like the guy who said, I'm a hard worker and hard work is good. You know, that, again, that resonated with me, but he doesn't have the employment opportunity. So what we really ought to be talking about is how he's going to get that. One idea is infrastructure. I mean, you can look at those films and you see these places really need some infrastructure. Now, this is something that the Trump administration has talked about, but it doesn't seem to be getting anywhere. And that's a concern of mine.
What's a particular thing that, if you could wave your magic wand, Doug, that you would like to see?
Look, the reality is this. You know, if you can only have the infrastructure if you can have businesses that are going to use it, and so that becomes an issue. The reality is that in the manufacturing sector, it's been automation. It takes 10% of the workers that it used to create the same things in the U.S. and export them, and so there are fewer opportunities. So you need to be the worker who can take advantage of those opportunities. It is unsurprising that people with a college degree have an unemployment rate of 2.5%. That's the magic elixir in this economy, and these communities have too many people who have not had the educational foundation to take advantage of that, and we're missing the programs that get people who want to work hard but do not have the skills up to speed.
Yeah, go ahead, Jared.
So here I have kind of flipped the politics a little bit. I'm completely for people being able to get all the skills they can, but if you can be all educated and still not have a job that will suffice for you in your community. And so here is where I think Donald Trump has said something important and useful, and it's not just about education or infrastructure, it's about trade. It's actually the case. He's right that these communities have been hurt by our large and persistent trade deficits. And so we need to take steps to reduce those as well. Again, I don't hear them really talking about it other than some tariffs, which are bad ideas, but there are good ways to do that also.
Okay, Doug Holtz-Eakin, a last word from you?
I think the trade piece is vastly overblown. I don't think that's the source of their problems. If you look at even the tape on Erie, their problems began in the 70s, well before we saw NAFTA, well before we saw the famed entry of China into WTO.
These are deep structural trends in the economy. These are places that had valuable resources, coal and transportation access, that no longer have those as their economic playing card. They need to create a new one, or the people who stay there simply aren't going to have an opportunity.
All right, Douglas Holtz-Eakin, Jared Bernstein, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And for a look at the extended length videos in this series, Betting on Trump, go to the NewsHour website. That's at pbs.org/newshour.